So please concentrate carefully. Okay. So two rotor in the sense, we have a situation where you have a long shaft. Like this and held between say frictionless bearings. And slips. Okay. So consider two rotors and different properties in the sense moment of inertia, mass moment of inertia. Let this be denoted by rotor A, and this is rotor B, and you have the shaft length L. Okay, so the shaft length is L, and here the shaft is having a common diameter throughout. So there are cases when we consider a composite shaft, or rather a compound shaft. Compound shaft means the different portions of the shaft will be having different diameters, like a series combination, like stepped shaft, different diameters for different length. So that will be there, and for that purpose we will consider torsionally equivalent shaft for the analysis. Otherwise, this is the case. We have a common diameter for the entire length, and length is L, and here the diameter is D, and the property values rotor A. So we have rotor A, and the attributes are IA, that is the mass moment of inertia, and here we have on the right hand side we have rotor B, and where the moment of inertia, mass moment of inertia, that is IB. So important thing here is the radius of gyration of the rotors is required to find out the mass moment of inertia. As I said, it is IA is equal to mass of the rotor MA, first rotor A, and MA into KA square. And similarly, mass moment of inertia of the second rotor IB is equal to mass of the rotor B multiplied by radius of gyration of rotor B squared. So MB KB squared. So you should remember these two aspects, where KA and KB are radius of radii of gyration of the two rotors A and B respectively. Okay, and then the length of the shaft, as I said, L, and this diameter is D. Now the we will consider the sense of rotation. See, when the torque is being applied, suppose you have a system and you want to test it, and then you know the type of torsional oscillation this system can have. അത് മനസ്സിലാക്കണമെന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ നമ്മൾ ഇത് സെൻസ് ഓഫ് റൊട്ടേഷൻ ഓഫ് ബോത്ത് റോട്ടേഴ്സ് അത് എങ്ങനെയായിരിക്കണം എന്നുള്ളത് ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻ്റ് ആണ്. ഫോർ എക്സാമ്പിൾ, ഇപ്പോൾ റോട്ടർ എ ക്ലോക്ക് വൈസ് ആൻഡ് റോട്ടർ ബി ഓൾസോ ക്ലോക്ക് വൈസ്, ദെൻ നോ ദർ വിൽ ദർ ഇസ് നോ ചാൻസ് ഓഫ് ടോർഷണൽ ഓസിലേഷൻസ്. ഒമേഗ ഇസ് ഈക്വൽ ടു സീറോ, സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇംപ്ലൈസ് റിജിഡ് ബോഡി ട്രാൻസ്ലേഷൻ. Okay, and this part is really important for you, and please try to keep these ideas in mind. IA, IB, omega is equal to zero is a part of the solution. Actually, that makes it a single degree of freedom system. Adine reason ini nammal parayunu, njan nathe paranjallo, if the rotor A and rotor B, if they have the same sense of rotation, then there won't be there will not be any chance of torsional oscillations. Okay, so this is important. So that definitely means when they have different senses of rotation, see if one is clockwise, the other one should be anti-clockwise, in that case there will be torsional oscillations. What is mode shape? Mode shape means it's a diagrammatic representation of the relative amplitude of the rotors of the bodies in a vibrating system. So here one particular mode shape can be this one. So one particular mode shape means, see the amplitude, see like this one, both are in the same direction in the sense. So here if this is say theta A or YA, okay, So you can write amplitude, say y a or theta a, and this side theta b. This is actually amplitude y b, since it is torsional, represented by the angular displacement. Okay, and this one, and if you just normally we shade it, and relative both ends will represent the same amplitude. So that is one possibility. This is one possibility of a mode shape, not quite useful. But the other one now, see, that is important for you. So that one, in the sense, there will be a node in between. And when they have different senses of rotation, the mode shape, this is one possibility. And now the second one, the second possibility. So that's what we are going to consider. And that is going to be quite useful for us. And we will search for the node position and the amplitude of oscillations. So in that case, what you're going to get is, this is going to be shape. So let me draw that one here. This is a length, and they have different sense of rotation, in the sense the rotor A will be, let us say, anti-clockwise, and this one say clockwise. Okay, so they have different sense of rotation. If they have, then that is the second case. So if they have different sense of rotation like this, mode shape in this one, same, the first case for same sense of rotation. Let me write that, same sense of rotation. So that means no chance of torsional, no chance of torsional oscillation in this case, first case. And second case, now the different sense of rotation. So in that case, there will be a node. And as desired, we have the torsional oscillations about a particular point on the, in between the length L on the shaft axis. So it will be something like this, you know. And this side, it is upward, and then the other side is downward, or vice versa. And this is the case. And we cannot say that the node will be exactly at the middle. See, it all depends on the mass moment of inertia of the rotors and all. And that we will prove in a moment. Okay. And this point, see, as I told you, this need not be the middle, the midway between A and B. And this is the node, let us represent by N. And that is node. What do you mean by node? Node is actually a point where, you know, there is no amplitude. So the point of, let's say point of, this is point of zero amplitude. So that is meant by, you know, that's what is meant by node. So node N, and we have this end, we have A, the other end, we have B, and this is your, say, theta A, or amplitude here at this end is theta A, and amplitude at this end is theta B, and this is the mode shape for a two rotor system in which the rotors have opposite sense of rotation, and this is YB, okay, and then, so usually we will, we will shade such diagrams, you know. See the position of the node. So that means, see, it's here. This is the length from one end, say L, let me write LA. And the other side, it is LB. So L, obviously LA plus LB is equal to the total length. So this is LB. Okay, so we have the condition now, LA plus LB, to determine the node position. LA plus LB is equal to the total length L. So let's say equation number one. Okay. And now the next one. So what you can do is the natural frequency in this case. So what about the natural frequency? Natural frequency of transverse vibration. So how do you find out the torsional oscillations, omega n, for undamped systems? What is the equation? Omega n is equal to square root of, what is that? Torsional stiffness divided by the mass moment of inertia I. So kt by I. So we know it. Okay. And this one, omega n, in this case, the torsional stiffness. See, how do you find out the torsional stiffness of, torsional stiffness of the shaft actually. Okay. So torsional stiffness of the shaft, kt. So that is from equation of pure torsion or simple torsion, we can write.
So T by J is equal to G theta by L, and KT, so that means the torque divided by the angle of twist in radians, okay, the T torque per unit angle of twist, twisting moment applied per unit angle of twist, that is torsional stiffness, T by theta. And this T by theta is equal to, see, from the torsion equation, what you can write is GJ by L. Okay. And if you substitute over here, and yesterday we have derived it, in fact. So this omega n is equal to a square root of, if you substitute for KT, then it will be GJ. Then denominator we have I. So what you should remember is GJ by IL. Okay. And if you want the frequency in hertz, then Fn is equal to what? Omega n divided by 2 pi. Okay, so this is the equation. Now what you should do is, in our current case, present case, see, first let me consider rotor A. For rotor A side, if you consider, so what will be the natural frequency? So let us write omega n suffix A, because if you're considering the rotor side A, in effect, what I want to tell is, this is now, you know, this is now equivalent to two single degree of freedom shafts about the point about fixed at the node, and they are performing torsional oscillations. But sherikku parna idu 2 degree of freedom in the single degree of freedom in the concept like idu ethunna engena nu vechu kaniyale, see, the common logic is this one, and you have about the nodal point, see, the nodal point, suppose you have you know, a fixation here, and then two rotors, let me symbolically represent it. So this is the rotor. So this is your distance LA, and here the rotor has mass moment of inertia IA, and this is the nodal point N. And the same system on the other side. For the other side also, you have, see, let me draw it over here, the same. So this is the nodal point N, and for the other side also you have a similar system of a rotor. So like this fixation, and then you have the shaft length. Is this one? Okay, shaft length, and on the other side you have the second rotor with the same attribute. Say attribute in the sense, same mass moment of inertia as the original one. So this is the second one, let us say, and this is having mass moment of inertia IB, and the length is LB, and performing torsional oscillation about the same point. See, just like independent. And then important part is this omega n, the torsional oscillation for the first part. And the second part, if you consider, so if you have rotor side A, and this is for the rotor side B, and the torsional oscillations will have the same frequency, same natural frequency, because basically it's a combined system. So omega n A will be equal to omega n B. Okay, so it is equivalent to two separate single degree of torsional oscillation system, as shown in the figure. They have the same natural frequency. Say omega n a is equal to omega n b. This is the second condition, okay? And we can identify the node now. So how can you get it? Omega n a, so that is equal to square root of, just consider that both the, you know, sides l a l b of length of the shaft, they are made up of same material and same diameter. So in that case, modulus or rigidity g and j will be the same. So omega n a will be equal to g and j same, divided by, of course, what is different is the rotor A has mass moment of inertia IA, and the length of the left side portion is from the node to the rotor A is LA. So this is it. So this is, so let us say, equation number 2. And what about the other one now? So if you take omega NB, so what do you get? So omega NB, for the rotor B side, if you consider the torsional oscillations performed by the second part, as shown in the figure, will have natural frequency equal to, what is that, GJ divided by then rotor B mass moment of inertia IB, and the length of the node, you know, the length of the shaft from the node to the second rotor B, so that is LB. And G and J are same, because modulus or rigidity, same material of the shaft, both parts LA and LB, and they have the same diameter, say DA and DB, same diameter. So therefore, polar moment of inertia J. J is polar moment of inertia. So you know that being circular shafts, what is J? J. So J is same. J is equal to J A, which is equal to J B, because the reason is you have the diameter of the part A is same as diameter of the part B, and which we want to designate by say small d. So therefore your j has a common value that is pi by 32 d raised to 4. Okay, this is it. And g value also same. Needless to say, the same part, you know, the same shaft, parts of the same shaft. So they are made up of same material. Okay. So with same modulus or rigidity. So this is a real concept. And then now, how do you get to the node position LA and LB? How can you separate it out? See, LA plus LB is equal to L. See, this is one equation. This one is one equation. LA plus this one. Let me write this. See, this is one equation. LA plus LB is equal to L. So you can make use of this. And the second one is this. If by second equation, you will get by equating the natural frequency, considering both parts. Omega n a and omega n b, and you know that they are identical. Okay, this is the natural frequency ultimately we have to find out. So omega n for the given system, two rotor system, see, that is omega n a, which is equal to omega n b. See, as I have indicated above. Okay, so if you equate these two, what do you get? See, omega n a and omega n b, g j by I a l a, see, that is under root of this. See, this is the value of omega n a, and what is omega n b? See, under root of g j by I b l b, and if you square it and then common terms if you cancel out, so what do you get is, so what you can get is 1 by I a l a is equal to 1 by I b l b. Remember, I a and I b, mass moment of inertia of the two rotors a and b. And the LA, LB, you know that the distance of the node from the first rotor is LA and distance of the node from the second rotor is LB. Okay, so that is the idea. And now this is actually LB, it's not LA. This is, so 1 by IALA is equal to 1 by IBLB. If you take the reciprocal, so you'll get a regularized expression, which is ultimately required. IALA is equal to IBLB. And this is what we require to, in order to find out the nodal position. It's a very simple relation in a two rotor system. Okay, so IALA is equal to IBLB, and the other equation is LA plus. This is let me write this as equation say 4. So the first equation, that is LA plus LB is equal to L and total length, and then now we got this one. IALA is equal to IBLB. Okay. Okay, so this, from these two you can get. So from 1 and 4, so from the one equation 1 and equation 4, you can find out position of the node, position of the node means about which this torsional oscillations take place. And that is, node is a point where you do not have any amplitude at all. That means zero amplitude, no vibration effect at all. So position of the node n, so that will act like a fixed point, you know, that nodal point. So position of node n can be found out. Okay, so LA plus LB, which is equation 1. So you know this already. So you have LA plus LB is equal to L. And the other one, this is actually the first equation. Okay, and from this, from these equations 1 and 4, okay, you will be able to separate LA and LB. Okay, so and provided you know the mass moment of inertia of the two rotors, that's all. And then using the equation omega n, equation 2 and 3, you can find out the natural frequency. Now ultimately I will write that also. So if you want natural frequency given by omega n a, or you can say omega n b, because both are same. Okay, and the equation, if you want f n a and f n b, that also you can write. If you want f n a, then that will be, you know, 1 by 2 pi root of 1 by 2 pi root of g j by I a l a. So square root of g j by I a l a is omega n a. Okay, considering the two portions separately, as I have indicated in the figure. And you have f and b, so that is given by 1 by 2 pi root of GJ by IB LB. Important thing to notice, and here for both of them, FNA and FNB, FNA and FNB should be identical. Okay, so this is it, and these are either of these two. So they will be, these two are the equations you have to make use of, and they are, remember, these two are equal, any of this. So you have FNA is equal to FNB. Okay, that's important. See, this is about the two rotor system, and in a very simple sense. But the real problem is sometimes the problem, you know, you cannot solve that easily when this shaft in between connecting the two rotors, so they will not be having a common diameter for the entire length. Ipa length L ile diameter D aanu, pakshe ella case ilum ingane avanonilla. Namakku ivide different diameters for different portions ennu parayumba adine nammal vilikkunna stepped diameter shaft or oru compound shaft. So if a compound shaft is given, then what should be the approach ennullathu nammal pratheka orkanam. Appo ivide rendu equations njan already paranju 1 2 3 4 ennu mark cheyittund important equations ella 1 2 3 4. Okay, so that's all about it, and we are now ready to solve the numerical problem, provided we know how to tackle when you have the shaft which consists of different portions having different diameters. So namukku appo adine oru common question nammalodu chodikkarunde, what do you mean by torsionally equivalent shaft, and obtain an expression for it. Okay, torsionally equivalent shaft. Vary the diameter again, so like this, so one, two or three portions, okay, like this, and now we have the length like this, so it can have different portions. So I have indicated here four different portions. Okay, so this is just a minute. Okay, and the length, now length and diameter, see, first portion L1 D1 L2 D2 L3 D3 and L4 D4. So we have four different portions, say 1, and this is 1, and this portion is 2, and here we have 3, and this portion is 4. It may have any number of such coaxial portions, different diameters and the length, and we want to now designate by L1, and this one is D1, this is L2 and D2 and L3 and D3 and L4 and D4. So the length L1, L2, L3, L4 for the four portions, and diameters D1, D2, D3 and D4 respectively. And assume that they are made up of same material, then there is no question of choosing, say, G1, G2, G3, G4. So G will be same for all, say, like you can say G1 will be equal to G2, is equal to G3, is equal to G4, and so on. And let us denote it by, say, G. Okay, and but of course in this case J value will be different, you know, because the diameters are different. So earlier case the diameter was same for L1 and L2, the portions 1 and 2, but here the diameters, see, here in this case important is, see, what is important is your DA is equal to DB and is equal to D. Okay, and in this case the earlier case which we discussed. But now our effort is to get that such a kind of common diameter even in this case by converting this into a torsionally equivalent shaft having the same diameter, say equivalent diameter for the entire length, equivalent length, known as equivalent length, that may be different from L1 plus L2 plus L3 plus L4. Okay, now so what you are going to do is now J1, let me write that is polar moment of inertia for the first part, so that is pi d raised to d1 raised to 4 by 32. It's a very simple concept which you'll easily understand. J2 is equal to pi D2 raised to 4 by 32, and J3, and similarly you have J3, that is pi D3 raised to 4 by 32, and J4 is equal to pi by 32 D4 raised to 4. Okay, and so on. And now what we want to do is we want to convert this into an equivalent case. So this, the given, you know, this shape is, this is actually a compound shaft. This is actually a compound shaft. Or even this is several coaxial several coaxial shafts in series having different diameters and length. Okay, so figure, this figure is representing that compound shaft. This, and we have to convert this into an equivalent shaft. Okay, for the technical analysis of torsional vibrations, the given compound shaft can be converted into an equivalent shaft, an equivalent shaft having common diameter known as equivalent diameter. അപ്പോൾ അങ്ങനെ കിട്ടുന്ന ഡയമീറ്ററിനെ നമ്മൾ ഇക്വലന്റ് ഡയമീറ്റർ എന്ന് വിളിക്കും. ഡയമീറ്റർ ആൻഡ് ദ ലെങ്ത് നോൺ ആസ് ഇക്വലന്റ് ലെങ്ത്. ഓക്കെ, സോ ദിസ് ഈസ് ദ കോൺസെപ്റ്റ്, ഇക്വലന്റ് length. But what is the criteria for such conversion? See, that is now we have to discuss. And simply you cannot convert this, but the basic concept for the conversion of getting a torsionally equivalent shaft is the idea that the torsional stiffness of the given compound shaft must be same as the torsionally equivalent shaft. Okay, so which we convert. So when we convert the given compound shaft into a torsionally equivalent shaft, the torsional stiffness of both will be identical, or both of them, torsional stiffness must be identical. Okay, so for the technical analysis of torsional oscillations, so this is what we are going to do. Okay, so the torsionally equivalent shaft, the diameter is known as equivalent diameter, and the length is known as equivalent length, and the shaft is called a torsionally equivalent shaft. That's very important. And this is made for the purpose of analyzing torsional vibrations and the torsion studies. Okay, so this is the basic idea. And now how do we get that the same torsional stiffness? So the given important point is the given compound shaft and the torsionally equivalent shaft, torsionally equivalent shaft, torsionally equivalent shaft will have, see, both of them should have the same torsional stiffness. So both of them should have the same torsional stiffness. So very important. Or they will undergo the same angle of twist when you apply a certain torque. Okay, so that is the basic idea, because you know that this torsional stiffness, when you say KT, that is equal to the twisting moment, the torque applied, or torque applied divided by the angle of twist undergone by the shaft. So KT is equal to T by theta. So we know the concept of torsional stiffness, or even its value is actually the torque or twisting moment required to produce unit angle of twist, that is 1 radian, and its unit you know that Newton meter per radian. Of course, radian is dimensionless. Okay, so you know this concept. So both of them should have the same torsional stiffness, that is the vital point. So the given compound shaft and the torsionally equivalent shaft, they should have the same torsional stiffness. So how do we find out that? Now let's say the equivalent shaft, torsionally equivalent shaft, has the torsional stiffness K suffix T. Okay, and then the given compound shaft that has different parts. So that means the first part, the torsional stiffness is say KT1, and the second part has the torsional stiffness KT2, and the third part the torsion of stiffness is AT3 and so on. Okay. So how do we find it out? KT1, KT2 and KT3 and different. And how do we find out that? So let me write, in a symbolic manner, and then we will add them up. So KT1, KT2, KT3, and the fourth part is the torsion of stiffness is KT4. So KT is equal to GJ by L. Okay, so T theta, and let me write that also here. We have considered that before. KT is also equal to, from the equation of simple torsion, it is GJ by L. T by theta is equal to GJ by L. And from our equation of pure torsion, T by J is equal to G theta by L. So GJ1 by L1, that is, KT1. And then the next one is GJ2 divided by L2. And this one, GJ3 divided by L3. And this fourth part, GJ4 divided by L4 and so on. Okay. And now, see, what I want to tell is that, you know, that when you have several shafts in series, or even several springs in series, then the linear stiffnesses, what do you do? So when you have the equivalent stiffness will be the sum of the reciprocal. The reciprocal of the equivalent stiffness will be the sum of the reciprocals of the individual ones, so like that. So adu pole appo namukku ivadte case la ad engenaanu nammal cheynadu ennaan ippo nammal nokkan povunadu. So equivalent stiffness adu pole springs inde case il nammal paranjathu pole springs series il aanengi stiffness ennu parayunnathu equivalent stiffness koraya cheyyune. So total stiffness ennu parayumbam 1 by k is equal to 1 by k1 plus 1 by k2 plus 1 by k3 plus 1 by k4 plus etc. But when the stiffnesses are in parallel, nammala idinde forced vibration il machine mount cheynathu number of springs il aanengile, if they are in parallel combination, the stiffnesses will be added up. Equivalent stiffness ennu parayunnathu simply add cheyyamadi ella. Appa stiffness inde case il nammala resistance parayna electrical resistance inde theory ida opposite a cheyyna. Appa parallel resistances cheyyna poleyana ivide series stiffnesses ine cheyyendathu എന്നുള്ളത് പ്രത്യേകം ഓർക്കണം. അപ്പൊ ഈ കേസിൽ ഇപ്പൊ എടുത്തു പറയാനായിട്ടുള്ളത്, ടു കട്ട് ദ സ്റ്റോറി ഷോർട്ട്, സി 1 by k, ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് 1 by kt ഇസ് ഈക്വൽ ടു സി ഇറ്റ്സ് 1 by kt1 പ്ലസ് 1 by kt2 പ്ലസ് 1 by kt3 പ്ലസ് എറ്റ്സെട്രാ. ഓക്കെ. So we have four parts. Let me write the fourth part also, then plus etc. If you have number of parts, okay. So if required. So any, if you want to generalize, and appo adu orthirikkanda oru main karyamaanu njan ippo paranjathu 1 by k. But remember, this is for combination in for series combination. This is for series combination. Okay. So anganeyanengile parallel combination simply, kt is equal to kt1 plus kt2 plus kt3 plus kt4. So we are not considering several shafts in parallel combination here. Here we have several shafts in series. They are coaxial too. So 1 by kt equivalent stiffness will be reduced in that case. Okay, appo equation like onnu substitute cheyamo. So you have kt1 is equal to this one, kt2 is equal to this one, kt3 is equal to this one, and kt4 is equal to this one. And then if you substitute, assume that they are made up of same material, G is common. So therefore, if you take the reciprocal, see, ippo njan reciprocal eduthaan ippo parayan povunnathu, and for kt ennullathu, this is the combination for equivalent shaft. See, this is the one for equivalent shaft, for torsionally equivalent shaft, and its torsional stiffness is GJ by L. Okay, and so please substitute that now. So torsional stiffness, so just substitute for, instead of 1 by kt, so what you can write is L by the reciprocal. See, I'm taking L by GJ. So like this. And here it is 1 by KT1 is equal to L1 by GJ1. I need not write G1, G2, G3, G4 because they are same. Okay. And G common, that will suffice. So plus L2 divided by G times J2 and plus L3 divided by G times J3. And this is L4 divided by G times J4 and so on. Okay, so now let me write that here. This one, L by GJ. What you can do is you can simply cancel out these modulus of rigidity part, that is this G is here and G is here, So multiplying throughout by G, you can get rid of that. And now you please substitute this also J1, J2, J3, J4, etc. So that is in terms of diameter, you can write now J1 is pi D1 raised to 4 by 32, pi J2 pi D2 raised to 4 by 32, and so on. Okay. So if you do that, then substitute, now you know, substitute J1, J2, J3, J4, etc. And cancel out G from all terms. So what you can get is, see, let me simplify the task now, because J is pi by 32 D raised to 4. In fact, that will be very common then. So it is L divided by, so what you can get is G will be cancelled, and J is that pi by 32 is common. And here it is D raised to 4. And from all the terms, I can try, I can take that 1 by, you know, that pi by 32 common, and you can cancel them out. So pi by 32, so this much I can take common from the denominator. So what I can get is L1 by D1 raised to 4 plus L2 by D2 raised to 4 plus L3 by D3 raised to 4 plus etc. Okay, so this is what you're going to get. Okay, and finally, and if you want to, you know, combine the terms now, then pi by 32, that if you want to simplify this, and your pi by 32 and pi by 32, you know, so this can be cancelled. And what remains is L by, that is a required expression for us, L by D raised to 4, and that is equal to L1 by D1 raised to 4 plus L2 by D2 raised to 4 plus L3 by D3 raised to 4 plus so on. And so on, okay, and even L4 by D4 raised to 4, and so on. And this is the equation we have to use in order to, if you want to convert the given compound shafts into an equivalent, a series combination of shafts having different diameters for the different length, and they are coaxial too, and we can convert them into a torsionally equivalent shaft by this, where L is the length of the torsionally equivalent shaft, and D is the diameter of the torsionally equivalent shaft. And the diameter of the torsionally equivalent shaft is called equivalent diameter, and length of torsionally equivalent shaft is known as equivalent length. But we have simply one equation, and we have to find out two variables, equivalent length and equivalent diameter. So that means for majority of the purposes, what we do is one will be chosen. So if you choose equivalent diameter, then you can find out equivalent length accordingly. And if you choose equivalent length, then you can find out equivalent diameter. So many a times we will choose an equivalent diameter from the context. For example, out of the diameters of the compound pipe, different portions D1, D2, D3, D4, etc., let us choose one diameter as equivalent diameter. Say, for example, D1. So if D1, see, the basic idea is this one. So that's what you have to keep in mind. So if D1 is chosen as equivalent diameter D, if equivalent diameter, say D, equivalent diameter is D. Okay, so in this equation, so you can substitute. So let's say Roman numeral 1. Okay, so if I want to get the equivalent length in that case, so how do you get it? So just substitute. So substitute in 5. Substitute in equation 1. Okay, so what do you get? That is L is equal to L by D1 raised to 4, because the equivalent diameter is taken as D1. The first portion diameter of the given compound pipe, the first portion has the diameter D1, that is chosen as the equivalent diameter. So if D1 is chosen as the equivalent diameter, then the equation 1 will become L by D1 raised to 4, that is equal to L1 by D1 raised to 4 plus L2 by D2 raised to 4 plus L3 by D3 raised to 4 plus L4 by D4 raised to 4, and so on. Okay. And then in this case, now we can simplify this equivalent length L. So multiplying throughout by D1 raised to 4. So just multiply this relation throughout by D1 raised to 4. So what will be the result? So multiplying this, just multiply this by D1 raised to 4. So what you can get is, see, left hand side will be left out with L only. So left hand side you'll get L, and right hand side now each term
is equal to L1 by D1 raised, L1 by D1 raised 4 denominator cut
out. So L1 plus then L2, L2 into then that part, you know, that D1 raised to 4 by D2 raised to 4. So what I can write is D1 by D2 whole raised to, because that raised to 4 is common. And then plus the third term will be L3 into numerator, we have D1 raised to 4. And denominator, we have D3. So D1 by D3, you can write whole raised to 4. And if you want to write one more term, let me write L4, that also. L4 into, what is that? D1 raised to 4 by D4 raised to 4. So D1 by D4 whole raised to 4. Okay, so like plus, etc. So this is it. You can write any number of terms. So this is the equation for torsionally equivalent shaft. Provided we choose D1 as the equivalent diameter, because we have only one equation to correlate. Okay, so that is an important idea. So this is say equation number, say Roman numeral 2. Okay, so this is what we have to use. And if you solve this, you know, if you use this concept, you will be able to solve this question. See, I have taken, this is an exam question, your exam question, okay, or KTU exam question for 10 marks, and I think you will be in a position to solve it. There won't be any difficulty at all. A steel shaft 1.5 meter long is 95 mm in diameter for the first 0.6 meter of its length, then 60 mm in diameter for the next 0.5 meter of length, and 50 mm in diameter for the remaining 0.4 meter of its length. So that means it has the given shaft has three parts. The first part, the length is 0.6 meter, diameter 0.095 meter, that is 95 mm. And the second portion, 0.5 meter length, and the diameter is 60 mm, that is 0.06 meter. And the third portion, the length is 0.4 meter, and the diameter is 50 mm, that is 0.05 meter. So the total length of the shaft, you know, L, that is equal to that L in the sense it's not equivalent for the compound pipe. Of course, for the equivalent, that will be different, that we will obtain by using the equation which we just obtained. Okay, so what you're going to do is the total length at present for the compound shaft is 0.6, and then 0.5 for the second portion, 0.4 for the third portion. So it is 1.5. So total is 1.5 meters. Okay, that is not the equivalent length, but that is the total length of the given compound shaft. So please do remember that aspect. The shaft carries two flywheels at two ends, two flywheels. So typically, this is the case which we discussed earlier. The first having a mass of 900 kg and 0.85 meter radius of gyration. You know what the paper setters are aiming at. See, the mass is given and the radius of gyration is 0.85. Definitely, that is for finding the mass moment of inertia of the flywheel. So here, the two flywheels are the two rotors. So you know what is a flywheel, okay? So that's a heavy wheel used for storing kinetic energy of rotation. So mass of flywheel and radius of gyration of the first flywheel, from that you will be finding out the mass moment of inertia of the first flywheel. And then it is located at the 95 mm diameter end. So that is located at the first portion. So that's it. So that first flywheel is located at the 95 mm diameter portion, the biggest one, in fact, out of the three. So that is leftmost. We can make use of that while, you know, drawing schematic diagram. You please take care of that fact. And the second flywheel is having mass of 700 kg. That is M. Let us say flywheels A and B. Then MB is M suffix B, 700 kg, and its radius of gyration 0.55. That is K suffix B. Then you, from that, you can find out mass moment of inertia of the second flywheel. So IA and IB can be found out. You know, I is equal to MK square. K is the radius of gyration. So IA is equal to MA KA square. IB is equal to MB KB square. So we have written those relations already. And the unit of mass moment of inertia, when you use SI units, that is kilogram meter square. Now determine the location of the node and the natural frequency of a free torsional vibration of the system. So you know that FNA and FNB, or omega N and omega NB, they are equal, and you have to find them out. And then the location of the node N, so the zero amplitude point on the equivalent shaft length, you know, so that we will be locating the modulus or rigidity G of the material, that's given. So even though the shaft has three portions, we assume that they are made up of the same material, that is steel, and 1.5 meter long. In fact, that length is given. I have added them up and I told you that 1.5. So in fact, that is given. Okay, so 80 giga newton per meter square, or giga pascal, that is G. So in fact, all these values are available. Only what we require is some schematic diagram and use these equations and then obtain the answer. Okay. Let's say this portion, and the third is 50 and even smaller. even smaller for the remaining length, and that length also is I think less 0.4. okay, and then we have the second rotor over there, second rotor, and then see the rotor mass is 900 kg for the first one and the second one 700 kg and all. Okay, 900 700 kg. So let me draw a smaller rotor. So this is a smaller rotor. It's all symbolic, you know, like we are not taking any dimension at all, but only the length under consideration. So we have taken you know, the proportionate dimensions. Okay, so this is what we are going to do now, and this length, let me write this as say L1. You know, before this, let me write one. Okay, let it be L1. This will be rather confusing then. So this is say L1, and here the diameter is D1, and here this is diameter D2, this is diameter D3, and we have the dimensions also, and this is L2, and this one is L3. Okay, and this is rotor A, and the other side we have this is rotor B and IA. So we have these are the two rotors, so rotor A and rotor B. Okay, and IA is equal to, so you can calculate and then get me the value MAKA square, and IA is equal to mass moment of inertia. So let me write that also, mass moment of inertia of the rotors. Okay, so that's what we are trying to find out, mass moment of inertia of the rotors. So what is MA? See, 900 kg and 0.85 radius of gyration. So MA is 900 kg and this one is 0.85 square. Okay, and 900 is in kilogram, and this one is in meters. So you'll get IA is equal to, so what is the answer? That much,
sir,
650.25 kilogram meter square. Okay, so that is IA. And now what is IB? So similarly, the second rotor has 700 kg mass and 0.55 meter radius of gyration. So the second mass, similarly, IB is equal to MB into KB square. Radius of gyration is KB for the second rotor. So MB is 700 multiplied by 0.55 meters, and so that's square. So you'll get the value now.
211.75.
Okay, 211.75 kilogram meter square. Okay, so IB. So we got the mass moment of inertia of the two rotors. Okay, so once you get this, the next procedure is of equivalent shaft, because of the given compound nature. The combination is in series, so we will find out equivalent shaft. So we will choose now D1 as the equivalent diameter. So L1, so before that, let me fill in those dimensions over here. So 95 for 0.6 and 60 mm and 50 mm. Okay, so this is 95 mm, so 0.095, okay, meter, and D2 is 0.06 meter, and the third one is 50 mm, 0.05 meter, and the length is first portion, it is 0.6 meter, and the second one is 0.5 meter, and the third portion, it is 0.4 meter. Okay, let us choose D1 as equivalent diameter, equivalent dia. Okay, and so what do you get? D1, so D1, you know, of course, 0.95 and 0.095 meter. Okay, and then the equation, then equivalent length. In that case, if you choose this one as equivalent diameter, then equivalent length, length will be what? Equivalent length L will be equal to, what is that equation? You know, L1 plus L1. Do you remember that? L1 plus, see the equation number 2, Roman numeral 2, this one. See, we have chosen D1 as the equivalent diameter in the general case also. So this is how we got, you know, this is the equation we got. So L1 plus L2 into D1 raised to 4 by d2 raised to 4 plus l3 into d1 raised to 4 by d3 raised to 4 plus etc. So we have three parts, so we'll consider the first three terms. So l1 plus l2 into d1 divided by d2 raised to 4 plus l3 into d1 divided by d3 raised to 4. Don't get confused. So very simple one. So we stop here because only three portions we have. So we don't require further term. And so what is L1? L1 for the first part, the length is 0.6 meter for the first portion. And L2, that is 0.5. And the diameters now, D1 is 0.095 divided by D2 is 0.06. See, remember all these dimensions are in meters. Then raised to 4 plus L3. It is 0.4, that is 40 centimeter for the third portion, that 0.4 meter into D1 is 0.095 itself, divided by D3 is 0.05, okay, 0.5 raised to 4. So please calculate this, so we'll get an equivalent length, some meters. So this is for the torsional equivalent shaft.
8.955, almost 9.
Okay, but still we write, we take the decimal place. What is it?
8.955.
Okay, 9.55. Very good. See, the total length actually, that is 1.5 for the compound shaft if the three parts taken together. But now we got 8.96 nearly meters. Okay, little less than 9. To find the node n, it is actually a single node system. Node N, okay, and we'll try to mark it on the equivalent shaft. Node N on the equivalent shaft. So what is that condition? So the condition is LA plus LB is equal to L. So what is LA? LA you have to find out, LN. So LA plus LB, now that is equal to the equivalent length 8.955. But now the second equation, so what do we know? That is IA LA. For a two rotor system, IALA is equal to IBLB. See, one thing I forgot to tell you, LA by LB, see from this, if you want the relation LA by LB, so what do you get? LA by LB will be IB by IA. So the node actually, depends on the ratio of their mass moment of inertia of the two rotors, IA and IB, IB by IA here. So LA by LB. See, this is an important relation. This conveys some facts. LA by LB is equal to the nodal position divides the entire length in the inverse ratio of their mass moment of inertia. Okay, so if you have two rotors and the inverse ratio on the A to B, and we already parayumbo, inverse ratio means IB by IA, and that will be equal to LA by LB. So the node N divides the total length L in the inverse ratio of the mass moment of inertia of the two rotors. So that is important. So from this, you can have such an idea also. So this is actually, say from equation, let's say 2. So this is equation 2. Okay. 0.25, and then that multiplied by LA, it is equal to 211.75 times LB. Okay, that is second equation. Then what is that? What you can do is LA is equal to 211.75 divided by 650.25. Okay, so you can write LA in terms of LB. So please write that. So what is LA then? Since IB...
0.3256.
0.3256. Okay, so it can be 0.326 LB. Okay, very important. And this is, let's say, equation number 3. And so now the node, actually the second one, the first one is IA is more, in fact 650 point that. So naturally the node will be very close to the rotor A, because that IA is more. LA plus LB is equal to 8.955, and in this LA you can substitute 0.326 LB plus LB, simultaneous equations we have 8.955. Okay, so you'll get 1.326 LB is equal to 8.955. Okay, and so what is LB? So from this, what is LB? Oh, three digits sufficient. So anyway, this is the answer. So LB is this. So you have LB is this and LA now. So please obtain the value 8.955 minus this LB, or it is 0.326 into 6.7534. So whatever be the method, you please calculate LA also now. So from this you can get
2.2016.
2.2016, eh? Anyway, 3 digits sufficient, I think, because the order of millimeters, that is sufficient. Because so you can even write so say LB, so you can round it off, approximately 6.753 meters, and your LA is 2.202, if you round it off, 2.202 meters. Mode shape means that is the diagram showing the relative amplitude of torsional vibrations in this case. Mode shape, and so what I do is I'll represent the total length, the length of the equivalent shaft. Okay, so 8.955, and out of which I want to separate out LA. So this is the side A. What I want to do is this is one side, and this is the other side. Or you can have the opposite. You know, the amplitude you can show in the opposite direction also. There's no problem. And only concern is the sensor rotation of the two rotors, you know, that should be opposite. Only then the torsional oscillations or torsional vibrations will be induced. So this is like this. But after marking the length, we can show the relative amplitude, because which one is bigger and which one is smaller, and that also we can judge now. So LA and LB, the length LA is 2.202. The node is very close to the rotor A side. So the rotor A, see that side is here, and the rotor B, the side here, and so the node is very close to that. So 2.202. So let me draw somewhere here, and see what I want to pinpoint is here the amplitude will be less than, and here the dimensions. Let me mark the dimensions also. So this is the nodal position, and this one is my LA. LA is equal to 2.202. Okay, 2.202 meters. And the remaining length, of course, is LB, that we will mark, let's say here. Okay, so the total length is 8.955. Okay, so this is, this length is LB. So this is LB, which is equal to 6.753 meters. And the point, the nodal point is here. This is your N, node N. Okay. So this is the node N. Okay. Oh, relative amplitude. If see, if you draw like this, you know, if you draw a straight line from here after showing one side amplitude, see one amplitude, if you take one unit, some distance, the other unit, you know, you can specify. See, if you are asked to find out the relative amplitude, that's how you should solve this question. Okay, just a minute, I will show the relative amplitude also in this diagram. See, so it will be. So if I show this much, the other amplitude, you know, the other side amplitude, if you draw a straight line from here, it will be nearly 3 times, because the length ratio, see, you know that. Okay, so here either you can write YA, or since it is torsional, you can write theta A. And here it is, you know, YB, that is, here it is theta B. Okay, theta B is obviously more because of this, you know, the length on the right side portion is more. So if you draw like this, definitely you understand. So if somebody asks you the relative amplitude, then if you can, what you can answer is, if theta A, the amplitude, theta A is one unit, just whatever be the unit, okay? So one unit in say radian or whatever. So theta A is one unit, then theta B, how much it is, you can tell based on the length in the division, because these two triangles which I have drawn now, to the left and right of the node, they are similar. So the length ratio, so they will be like, you know, so how do you find out theta? This will be, that also I'll write theta A, you know, by theta B. So if you take those sides ratio, and that will be same as this length ratio also, LA by LB. But remember, for the two node rotor systems, the mass moment of inertia of the rotors, they are in the inverse ratio, IB by IA. Okay, if you compare it with LA by LB. So theta A by theta B is equal to this one. So therefore theta B will be, so from this, you know, theta B will be LA by LB into, theta B will be, sorry, LB by LA LB by LA into what? Into theta A. So if theta A is one unit, then naturally this you take this ratio. That's all. So what is that ratio? Can you please tell me? Then in that case, so what will be so theta A? This. So please do remember from the mode shape, from the property of similar triangles. Okay. From this is how do we get it? From similar triangles. From the geometry of the mode shape, from the similar triangles over there, showing the relative amplitude theta A and theta B. So you get theta A by theta B is LA by LB. So what is LB? LB is 6.753 divided by LA is 2.202. And what is that? So what is this ratio? So theta B is
3.066.
Ah, okay. So 3.07 times this times theta A to what? 3.066 or 07, that much into theta A is taken as C, one unit. So if theta A is taken as one unit, this is 3.07 units into theta A. Okay. So that is if. So if theta A is equal to one unit, we cannot find out the absolute ones, but if theta A is taken as one unit compared with theta A, theta B is more than three times theta A. So theta B is 3.07 times theta A. That is, if theta A is one unit, theta B is 3.07 units. Okay, so that is about the mode shape. And then, of course, you can shade it and then show. Okay, I'll show a different inclination on the other side. Okay, and both will be having the same, both portions will be having the same frequency, natural frequency of torsional oscillations. I told you already, with respect to the node, if you treat node as the fixed point, it will be like two rotors, you know, they are having torsional oscillations about the point N, independent, two independent rotors, and they have torsional oscillations with the same frequency. So we know that FNA is equal to, so what is that? FN is equal to, what is that? FNA, which is equal to FNB. Okay, and what is FNA? And either anyone, I mean, both of them must be same, because, you know, we have derived the remaining relations based on this only. So either you can take, you know, FNA means what? It is in hertz, you know, so it is 1 by 2 pi root of GJ G by J is the same now, so you need not write JA because of the equivalent, equivalent. So I'll remove that. So GJ by IALA. Okay, anyone. So either you use this or what is that? 1 by 2 pi root of, you know, GJ by IBLB. So any of these, okay? You need not calculate both. Anyone. So,
sir, 7.996.
7.996. Okay, nearly 8 even. Into 10 to the power of?
Minus 6 into 10 raised to minus 6.
Okay. So 7.998 into 10 to the power of minus 6 meter raised to 4. So that is the polar moment of inertia of this equivalent shaft. Okay. With the diameter, of course, you know, the diameter is 0.095 meter, 95 mm. Okay. So we are making use of, this is the diameter. Okay. So you got that G, and the value of G is given in the question, modulus or rigidity of the steel shaft. It is 80 giganewton per meter square. So G is 80 gigapascal. G is equal to 80 giganewton per meter square. That is 80 gigapascal, 80 into 10 to the power of 9, that much pascal or newton per meter square. Okay. So we'll substitute this, and omega n is equal to root of, you know, that GJ by GJ by IL. And in this case, omega n a you can calculate, then IALA. Okay. Any one part you solve it. I mean, use that. That's all. Okay. Don't try to, you know, use both. And even if you use both, then the answer must be identical. So omega n a. So we will calculate omega n a, which is of course equal to omega n. Okay. Right. So that is square root of, so please do calculate this part also, this part. Okay. So this one giga, 80 gigapascal, 80 into 10 to the power of 9, then multiplied by J is 7.998, even 8 you can say, into 10 to the power of minus 6. Okay, be very careful in substitution, and your IA is equal to 650.25, and your length LA after finding the node, you know, you got LA is equal to 2.202. Okay, so you'll get omega n a. So omega n a, you'll get
21.139.
Okay, 139. Okay, then of course you can write 14 if the fourth place, the digit at the fourth place is more than 5. Okay, so that much radian per second. Okay, right. So this is omega n a, and f n a. So f n a will be this divided by 2 pi. So this value divided by 2 pi. Omega n. Omega n a divided by 2 pi. What is that value?
3.364.
Okay, 3.364 hertz, or revolution per second, or cycles per second, or second inverse. So this many torsional oscillations in 1 second. 3.364 torsional oscillations in 1 second. So that is the meaning of it. So the answer, final answer, is this one. So this is the answer. Answer we'll write here. See, torsional oscillation f n. So one value. So that is 3.364 hertz. Okay, and along with that, we located the node as well as the relative amplitude. Also, we specified. More importantly, when you have one more rotor, three rotor. So when we use the concept as we discussed here. So when you have a three rotor system, so the degree of freedom will become 2, and so you will be having 2 natural frequencies. Actually, this diagram depicts everything. I mean, either mode shape or this reveal the whole fact about this torsional vibrations in the given system. Namakki thannirikkunnathu. And provided this all will be correct, you know, provided the numerical input you are given, e values okka calculate cheythu paranjathu correct aanengil, then everything is okay. And meanwhile, you can even calculate FNB also. Idile FNB kuda kandupidichittu just to make sure that they are correct. Angane aagum, karena aa vidathilana nammal ee relation IA into LA is equal to IB into LB ennokka kittiyathu by equating what omega NA is equal to omega NB, or FNA is equal to FNB. Adu equate cheythu kittiya condition aanu idu. Since we have used this condition to find out the node, then definitely after getting these distances LA and LB representing the proper location of the node, if you calculate omega NA and omega NB, or FNA and FNB, they must be same.